Oh boy. Here is unit 9. And the element of the day is nitrogen. Every breath you take is mostly nitrogen. About 80% of the breaths you take by weight are nitrogen. There's also some CO2 and some O2 in there. CO2 will kill you, and the latter allows you to remove waste carbon from your body. CO2 will actually kill you because the purpose of O2 is to remove waste carbon from your body as far as mammals and other respirating creatures are concerned. You can have an environment that is 80% oxygen and 20% CO2 and you will still die because your body just can't cope with the presence of the CO2. Your body goes through something called the Krebs cycle. Because you're a sophisticated mammal and you have mitochondria inside of your body. And after the Krebs cycle is done, you've got a whole bunch of ADC, ATC? I think it's ATC. No biologist, me. A whole bunch of ATC generated, and that's created a lot of waste carbon. If that waste carbon gets to float around your cells, you're going to die. And so a big part of the purpose of blood is to return to your lungs with all of that excess carbon and let the carbon stick to the oxygen in your blood, stick the oxygen that's filling your lungs, and get out of your body. If there's too much CO2, your lungs don't work well and they can't do that, and you literally drown because your cells can't get rid of carbon. So again, even with 80% oxygen and 20% CO2, you will still die. Carbon poisoning, carbon dioxide poisoning, no joke. Now, nitrogen as a dimer, which if you've already taken chemistry means nitrogen stuck with nitrogen. Every dimer is two identical elements joined together. It's just heavy enough that lots of planets are holding on to it. Mars still has some, Venus has a lot, so on and so forth. Although the only other world in the solar system that has an atmosphere that is mostly nitrogen is the moon Titan, which is, last time I checked, in orbit around Saturn. Planetary bodies move around all the time, so who knows now. Also, because energy is always released when bonds are formed, and I'm amazed at how many people get through chemistry without learning this, energy is always released when bonds are formed, and energy is always consumed when bonds are broken. You can make quite a bit of energy by having nitrogen separated from nitrogen and then just letting them find each other again. Nitrogen is triple bonded. It's unusual for an element to triple bond to another element, and so it's making three bonds, whereas most elements and molecules make do with two or one. Consequently, when nitrogen finds nitrogen and the bonds are able to form between them, you make a lot of energy. This is why nitroglycerin works. This is why almost all explosives work. You bind nitrogen into the explosive. The molecular structure of the explosive is unstable enough that when you heat the explosive up, you get nitrogen being freed all over the place. That nitrogen is going to find another nitrogen, or at least a lot of it is. It forms a triple bond, and that makes a lot of energy. A ton of nitrogen finding a ton of other nitrogen makes a lot of energy. This is why almost every common explosive in the world works. This is what it does. It just has nitrogen bound up inside of its structure. Then the purpose of the explosive is just to let the nitrogen go so it can triple bond to itself. But that's not all nitrogen does. It's also necessary for plants to grow, and if you like to eat meat, then you like to eat things like to eat plants, unless you're eating top carnivores, in which case quit it because they're mostly endangered. And if you like to eat plants, you really need nitrogen. We would have all starved to death by now if German chemists hadn't figured out how to extract nitrogen from the atmosphere and put it in the soil so plants could grow in the Haber process. Unfortunately, because nitrogen is also used as an explosive, those same German chemists had figured out a technique that gave Germany access to essentially an unlimited amount of explosives and then world wars. So it's a double-edged sword, but without being able to take nitrogen out of the atmosphere and put it into the soil, we would not have access to nearly enough nitrogen to sustain. I haven't checked in on the world's population recently, but I'm going to say there's 8 billion of us. Put the right answer in the chat if you feel like it. So we haven't actually covered oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, and hydrogen in this class because we've been skipping all around my different lecture notes so as to focus on the topics that are most important to what's involved in 241. Nonetheless, I'm gonna play this awful video for you. At least I'm gonna try to.
There's no sounds of the video.
Are you not able to see or hear anything?
We can see, we can't hear.
Oh, all right. Let me see what I can do. Well, can you hear now? Nope. All right. So the key point of this video is that as far as life goes, most of life has oxygen in its elemental structure. Some of it is carbon, some of it is hydrogen, and a tiny little bit is nitrogen. And this is true across the board for all forms of life, like every living thing on Earth uses oxygen, carbon, hydrogen, and nitrogen to construct the majority of its body. The reason for this is not that these elements are ideal. The reason for this is that these elements are preferentially created in large amounts by stars. Like people have already manufactured synthetic DNA. So we clearly can make DNA that's based off of other molecular backgrounds and backbones. There's probably elements out there that work a lot better than hydrogen, nitrogen, carbon, and oxygen, but they don't exist in sufficient quantities for life to evolve from it. We're restricted to using those elements that are commonly available. And the reason those elements are commonly available is that they are. All right, I guess they're not going to have another example. Is it they are preferentially created by stars? So, back to the lecture. So today, I'm going to tell you about the interstellar medium and star formation, both the effects of gas and dust, the existence of brown dwarfs, what you can learn from examining molecules in astrophysics, and the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. I'm going to tell you a wee bit about what exoplanets are and how you find them. So, The sun and all of its planets are currently moving through the local interstellar cloud, which is, affectionately or not, called the local fluff. Fluff is an appropriate comparison because the density of this cloud is about 0.3 atoms per centimeter. On the other hand, the density of Earth's atmosphere at the edge of space, which is not where it is at its densest, is 1.2 times 10 to the 13th molecules per centimeter. So the difference is about 1 with 14 zeros after it. This image shows the patches of interstellar matter, mostly hydrogen gas. That's true everywhere in the universe. It's mostly hydrogen gas, within about 20 light years of the sun. The temperature of the local interstellar cloud is about 7,000 degrees Kelvin. That's about the temperature of the surface of the sun. It's pretty hot, but it really doesn't matter because there's practically nothing there. Remember, temperature is, in a very real sense, a measure of the velocity of molecules. So you can have a group of molecules with very low density be extremely hot, and it doesn't really matter. They're not transferring a bunch of heat simply because there's not that many of them. So we entered this cloud between 44,000 to 150,000 years ago, and we're expected to remain with it for another 10,000 to 20,000 years. Notice the range in those numbers. Again, this is because we can tell exactly what things' velocities are when they're going towards us, and exactly what velocity they have when they're going away from us. But the transitional velocity is almost impossible to detect. So we know about half of how fast things are moving, and we don't know about half of how fast things are moving, including this gas cloud we're going through. We don't even know if the greater and lesser Magellanic clouds are bound to the Milky Way or if they're just passing by. We don't know if Proxima Centauri is part of the Alpha Centauri and Beta Centauri system or if it's just passing by. That is the extent to which astronomers are good at measuring velocities, which is to say, we're really bad at it. So let's just see if YouTube is permanently broken. I don't really care too much about this video, but I do care to know if sound works. You guys getting anything?
Still no sound.
Tremendous. All right. Well, that's that then. I have no idea why. It's definitely not worth a reboot. So there's the Milky Way, which, because you missed the beginning of my astronomy class, because I never taught it to you, you haven't seen much of before. That big old bright thing in the center is the center globe of the Milky Way. The black hole in the center of it is called Sagittarius A, because the center of the Milky Way is in the constellation Sagittarius. And it should look like a bright spherical glow in the middle, and two thin arms extending out to either side. Because this is a weird wraparound image that contains 360 degrees in the sky, it should only go about halfway through the picture. Because we are at the outskirts of the Milky Way, we can see pretty much the whole thing at once. And yet the Milky Way is run through with dark bands, going hither and yon, really obscuring our view of it. And that's because dust is super opaque to visible light. It is less opaque to red light than it is to blue light of a certainty, and it's pretty much transparent to infrared light. This is why if you ever get an astronomer hanging out with you and you want to make them cry, you should note that there is currently no working infrared telescope that is in space that astronomers have access to. We really, 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 really want one, and there isn't one. They've been working on one for, I'm going to estimate, the last 1,000 years, but it's never been launched, and it's probably going to break when it is launched. That would be the James Webb Space Telescope. So the interstellar medium is just what you'd think. It's the name for the material that fills the space in between stars. And sometimes it's denser than others. There's a nebula called the Elephant Trunks Nebula. And most nebulas are a relatively dense cloud of gas and dust. Keep in mind, when I say dense in terms of nebula, we're talking about something that is far thinner than the atmosphere of almost all planets. It's just denser than the normal interstellar medium. A nicer name for soot or dust is polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. And these big clouds of dust play a fairly key role in the formation of life because they are a place where molecules can form. We have found amino acids in dust clouds using exactly the technique you might suppose, using spectroscopy and looking at the absorption lines. This indicates how common amino acids are. No amino acids, no life, as far as we know. And NAPA students, at least those of you who live close to campus, have a particular edge in understanding what dust really does to astronomers. I want you to cast your mind back to last year, or the year before, or the year before, when the wildfires were happening. So sunlight was filtering through a gigantic cloud of soot. What color was the ground? Oh, wait. I know at least a few of you have mics, and I know that most of you have seen this. All right, I won't wait. Y'all are shy. The color of the ground was red, because red light can make it through soot. Blue light, green light, yellow light, purple light cannot make it through soot. This is why, when there's a big fire and the sky ends up full of soot, the ground turns red. Everything turns red. So wait 4 months when there's inevitably another round of wildfires. And as you strap on your N95s, which fortunately we all have one of now, and you go outside, look at the ground, look at the asphalt, look at the pavement. It's all red, because that's the only kind of light that can make it through that dust. Here's another nebula, just put up because it's beautiful. This is in the Sword of Orion, which is a area that is experiencing a fantastic amount of starbursts. Starburst happens in nebula because there's extra hydrogen and soot around there. Generally, the nebula has to be shocked by something. We haven't talked about supernova yet, although given that you're a 241 class, we definitely will. So stars explode. When that happens, they send out a shockwave. When that shockwave propagates through a gas cloud that is a little bit denser than the gas clouds around it, it forces the gas clouds to start spinning and contracting. To understand why, because you have taken a lot of physics, imagine a coffee cup on a table. Now, you're going to strike this coffee cup. There's only one real spot on it, or one real line on it, where you can strike the coffee cup and it's not going to start spinning. And that's dead in the center. If you strike it even a little bit to the side, it's going to spin. And the same is true of gas and dust. A shockwave comes in on it, hits the gas and dust, and almost inevitably the gas and the dust start spinning. Spinning will lead to contraction and flattening. Exact same way a ballerina spinning will go faster when they draw their arms in than they will when their arms are spread out. And also, in the exact same way that when you throw pizza dough up in the air, the pizza dough will spread out. So, those two things. Stars are made out of big clouds of gas because of ballerinas and pizza dough. So there's where this big dust cloud is. It's in Orion's sword. What you see is red is a hydrogen emission line. And I'm going to hit this particularly hard for your class because you are responsible for understanding spectroscopy in a way that my astronomy students aren't. Red is the lowest energy visual light that hydrogen emits. So if hydrogen is even a little bit shocked in such a way that the electrons are jumping around, it's going to emit red light more than any other kind of visual light. It mainly emits infrared light, but we can't see that. Remember that a hydrogen sign is pinkish. Because when you truly electrify hydrogen, you get all the colors, and hydrogen's got a fair amount of blue in it on top of the red. I guess blue plus red makes pink. The green colors you see are oxygen emission lines, again, for the exact same reason. When you electrify oxygen a little bit, green is the easiest thing for oxygen to emit. And the blue colors are just flat out reflected from hot stars. Dust not only absorbs blue light when it passes through it, but it also reflects blue light backwards. And because of conservation of energy, this is kind of what you expect. The light's got to go somewhere. It somewhat goes into warming up the dust, but it also gets backscattered and transits through the universe that way. So, again, here's the Orion Nebula, and let's tease the physics a little bit out. The reddish color is the first line in the Balmer series. Hydrogen emission indicates there's young, hot stars that ionize nearby clouds of gas. Remember, ionization means you take an electron away, or this isn't called ionization, but more commonly, you just kick the electron up to an extra energy level and then it falls back down. This creates emission lines. Red is the easiest emission line to create. It doesn't take a lot of energy. And the blue color is produced by small particles of dust that scatter the light from the hot stars. Hot stars being stars that create mainly blue light. We looked at black body radiation last time we did an astronomy lesson, and indeed, as the temperature got cranked up and up and up, the object emitted more and more and more blue light. Here's the North American Nebula, just because it's pretty and for no other reason. More nebula. Now, this is a significant and new image. This is what's called an open cluster. There's a lot of stars being born in this open cluster, but we only see the blue ones. That's because total luminosity goes as radius squared and t to the fourth. Blue stars are extremely large and also extremely hot. They pour out vastly more energy than any other kind of star. And so we see them from far away. There's more red dwarfs in that star birthing cluster than there are blue giants by a lot. But we can't see them. So the whole thing appears bluish. Also, notice how the nebula appears to be receding from it. That's because these blue stars are putting out a tremendous amount of energy. The nebula birthed them, and then once the stars came into formation, the energy they blasted out has pushed the nebula away from them. That energy of pushing will help the nebula spin and create new stars until finally the whole nebula is consumed. No more nebula. bunch of new stars. So the interstellar medium is the material that fills the space between stars, and it is still mostly gas. And of the gas, it's almost entirely hydrogen. Less than 1% of it is dust. And it's super thin. If a vacuum pump on Earth, like our best vacuum pumps, tried to suck out all the atoms in the air, the best vacuum pump on Earth still has 1 billion times more atom per cubic unit of volume than the interstellar medium does. I had to add per cubic unit of volume because y'all are good at physics. Another way of putting this, there are as many atoms in between your eye and the floor as there are in a column of interstellar gas from Earth to the center of the galaxy. And the center of the galaxy is 26,000 light years away. This is assuming that that column doesn't randomly intersect a star, which would completely mess up the math. But if it's just the interstellar medium, look at the floor. There's more atoms between your eye and the floor than there are if you go outside, look at Sagittarius and eye Sagittarius A. Which I don't even think you can do right now because the sun is in between us and Sagittarius. So, moot point. 90% hydrogen, 10% helium, trace amounts of heavier elements. Because nucleosynthesis is important to this class, I want to remind you once more, there was a point at which the entire universe was a star from one end to the other. It was just all of an appropriate temperature to be a star. And it was during that time that all of the helium was created. Or most of the helium was created. Because as you learned when we studied the sun, what a star would really like to do is take hydrogen and turn it into helium. When stars are doing that, they're living their normal, healthy life, and they're on the main sequence. Ooh, this slide exists solely to show you pictures of pretty nebula, and to emphasize how nebulas are different. Some nebulas form just because gas has gravity, and the more gravity you have, the more things you attract. Some nebula form because stars jet off a considerable portion of their mass close to the end of their life. The one up to the top left is a nebula that exists because stars have been pushing off their outer layers for a while. That's called a planetary nebula. The one up to the right is a nebula that is currently experiencing star formation, and the nebula is being burnt off by the stars that it recently created. You can see the dark pockets being blasted away by a couple of hot blue stars inside of it. The one to the bottom left is a nebula that is not currently yet experiencing a lot of star formation. And I don't know what the story is for the one to the bottom right. I just thought it was a great picture, and also I don't understand it. So if you understand it, put your comments in the chat, and I'd be delighted to hear them. That kind of filamentary structure is highly unusual for a nebula. It's not created by a star, a low mass star outgassing when it creates a planetary nebula. It's not created by a supernova that leaves behind a supernova remnant. And it doesn't look congruent with what I understand about how nebulas form due to clumping caused by gravitation. So I have no idea what's up with that. And yet apparently it exists. So another thing that we're going to deal with explicitly using physics in this class is, how do you see cold hydrogen? Well, imagine two magnets right next to each other. The energy level is different if the North Poles are both facing up and you have the South Poles sitting on the table as they're next to each other. Take one of the magnets and flip it so the North Pole is facing down and the South Pole is facing up, and you'll experience a different force in between the magnets. Something has changed. Hydrogen, poor hydrogen, has one proton and one electron circling it, and sometimes it has extra neutrons, in which case it's very special and precious. But regardless, the proton in the center has what's called a magnetic moment. It's got an orientation. It's more north to the top and south to the bottom, or vice versa. And so does the electron. If the electron switches from pointing, and here I'm making air quotes, up to pointing down, then there is an energy difference associated with that. Energy differences have to be accounted for. And so when the electron switches its orientation, it emits a photon. This is not a photon we can see. It's a photon with a wavelength about 21 centimeters, which is firmly in the radio regime. Remember that we see light of about 600-ish nanometers. So this light is quite a bit different. Here's a picture of actual dust in the interstellar medium. These grains are small, about the size of large molecules. They're a result of supernova remnants. Supernovas are the only kind of stars that make heavier elements and also give them up. So the dust is comprised of iron, silicon, carbon, that kind of stuff. It's also surrounded by an ice sheet. So these are called volatiles. You got water ice, ammonia ice. All right, I'm not going to remember the name of the last one. If anybody does, please put it in the chats. So these things are super tiny, and they collect ice. And we know what kind of ice it collects because we look at dust, and when dust ends up near a star that is heating it, all those volatiles jump off of it and re-become free-floating molecules, and then we can do spectroscopy on them to find out what kind of stuff was sticking to the rocky core. So, weirdly, compounds with deuterium in them, so deuterium is a form of hydrogen, it's one proton with an extra neutron stuck onto it, are less sticky than compounds with hydrogen. And that leads to a weird kind of signal where when you do spectroscopy, there's a lot more free deuterium in interstellar space than there should be. But when sunlight hits these dust grains, all the compounds on it get blasted off. They sublimate. They turn from a solid directly to being a gas, which technically the stuff in interstellar space is. And we can suddenly detect them, and then the deuterium excess is explained. We've already talked a lot about dust, but again, long wavelength stuff can make it through it. Red light kind of makes it through dust. Infrared light really makes it through dust. Astronomers are desperate for an infrared telescope because the water in our atmosphere is so good at blocking infrared radiation. We need to be able to see through dust. We also want to be able to look at the oldest galaxies. Now, galaxies emit visible light just because that's what stars emit in general. But these galaxies are so far away and receding from us so quickly that redshifting has made all their visible light turn into infrared light by the time it reaches us. Consequently, if we're to see to the true edges of the visible universe, if we're going to see these new birthing galaxies, then we need infrared telescopes. Because visible telescopes just won't cut it. That's not what the light is anymore. So here's a spectrum of a normal star if you could hang out next to it and look at it in orbit. And here's what it looks like after it passes through dust. A lot of information has been lost. Now you can blow it up and you get some kind of data, some spectral lines, but it's still not nearly as useful as being able to see the actual spectrum of the star. So dust really messes with astronomers. Thanks for life and all that, but it messes with our instruments. And I say thanks for life because when a big gas cloud starts to condense to form a solar system, most of the heavy elements that are going to be in that solar system are being carried by dust. So Earth could not be a solid rock were it not for dust in some way, shape, or form. This is called interstellar reddening. And it is, again, the same thing that you see when you look up through the smoke clouds from the fires, and the sun is reddish, and the ground is reddish, and everything is reddish. Because red light can make it through, and blue light can't. Looking through a dust cloud, here it is, invisible light. If you can take a picture in infrared light, which we haven't been able to do since IRAF quit working, you see this. There's a lot of stars there. We just can't see them with visible light. There's a big dust cloud between us and them. So we need an infrared telescope to actually tell what's out there. Here's a reflection nebula. It's the Pleiades. If it looks familiar to you, it's because the arrangement of those stars is the logo for the car company Subaru, which apparently is quite common in the Bay Area, based on what I can see as I drive on the freeways. It's a recently created open cluster, which is the kind of cluster that has starbirth happening within it. So you see a bunch of blue stars, and it's surrounded by a bunch of dust. And the dust absorbs blue light if you're directly in between the dust and the star. But if you're looking at the star a little bit off center, then the dust is also reflecting blue light, and you can see the bluish glow. This is absolutely true of the Pleiades, which is a wintertime, I mean, I can't say constellation. It's a wintertime asterism, which means an arrangement of stars that is not truly a constellation. So if you go outside in the winter and you go to a place that's truly dark, as in get in your car and get ready to drive almost all the way to the Sierra, then you can see that the blue stars that make up the Pleiades are surrounded by a bluish glow. And it's also close. It's only 400 light years away, and so it's quite bright. Now, not only do we need to use infrared light to see through the dust, but interstellar dust also glows faintly in the infrared. So these dust grains are absorbing or reflecting a bunch of blue and purple and green light every wavelength that can't make it through. Some of that light gets bounced back, hence reflection nebula, but a bunch of it gets absorbed, which warms up the dust grain. Objects that are warm but not too warm don't emit visible light, they emit infrared light. And so if you can see very clearly in the infrared, you can see where the dust clouds are. There's the last good infrared picture we got of the galaxy. So most of the galaxy is in a plane, thinner than a CD disc, if that comparison means anything to you in this modern era. Thinner than a record that goes into a record player. And the dust is highly concentrated in that plane. But we also have some out of the plane. You know, dust gets stirred up. Gets knocked out of the plane of the galaxy. And so we view that in infrared light. And all of a sudden, the dust distribution in the galaxy is visible. Here is another big dust cloud. This one's in Scorpius. And notice how the newly birthed hot stars are literally blasting the gas and the dust away from them. This is a good thing. That shockwave is going to create more stars and concentrate dust into those star regions so that we can have more interesting stellar systems once the star actually forms. And then here's a super famous picture called the Pillars of Creation. So there is a fancy name for nebula in the galaxy that have enough dust that interesting things will happen as the nebula starts to contract. We call them giant molecular clouds, and I don't care at all if you remember that, but that's the name. So there's a lot of dust and there's a lot of gas in there. Consequently, there's complicated molecules. But the thing that's interesting about this picture is that starbirth is happening along the fingers of the nebula. Newly birthed stars are literally burning the nebula away. And they're also sending a shockwave through those fingers, which is going to cause more starbirth. And then those stars are going to, in turn, blast the nebula away more, which is going to cause more starbursts. This is how nebulae disappear. It's literally the mechanism that makes them turn from being big clouds of gas and dust into being a bunch of star systems. So that whole picture is 100 light years across, and it's going to create what astronomers would call an open cluster, a vast star birthing region where the stars are all relatively concentrated next to each other. Because 100 light years is not that big in this galaxy. Remember, the galaxy itself is about 100,000 light years from one end to another. And so this is like 0.01% of the size of the galaxy. Let me know in the chat if I did that math wrong. I haven't seen any chats yet. Actually, let's do this thing again. Hit exclamation mark enter if you're actually here and paying attention. All right, great. I'm glad that most of you are here. Thank you very much. So, as a corollary to your being here, always feel free to stop me, turn on your mic, or ask a question in chat. I think I'm a decent teacher. At least I am when I'm not completely overwhelmed. But I don't think I'm such a decent teacher that I explain everything with such specificity that there shouldn't be any questions asked. So remember, you can always interrupt me for a question. This is an astronomy lecture, but everything about this lecture is 100% applicable to what we're going to do when we cover nuclear physics, which we're going to do for like a week. So let me know if there's anything you need extra explanation on. So whatever, there's a bunch of molecules and giant molecular clouds. That's where planets, rocky planets, and life come from. Carbon monoxide is not very sticky. It also kills you on Earth if you're an animal. So because it's not sticky, it doesn't spend very much time sticking to dust motes. And so you can see the absorption spectrum of carbon monoxide unless it's extremely, extremely, extremely cold. And in general, in the interstellar medium, it's not that cold. Remember, the typical temperature is 7,000 Kelvin. There's not that much stuff out there, but the stuff that there is out there is typically moving at a pretty fast speed. So we look for carbon monoxide when we want to know where complex chemicals might be, not because it's super common, but because it's the most common molecule that doesn't turn into ice easily. So let's look at what that means. There is the carbon monoxide emission that we see all around the Milky Way. And here is the dust that we see all around the Milky Way. Carbon monoxide, dust. Carbon monoxide, dust. So carbon monoxide is a lot easier to detect than dust because it's got a very specific absorption spectrum associated with it. Whereas with dust, we have to kind of look at it and either get an infrared signal from it, which we really can't anymore, because we have no working infrared space telescopes, or else know that there's a star on the other side of it and know the starlight is being extinguished by the dust, which is also hard to do. But CO2 is easy to find. Any kind of starlight shines through it at all. It's got a perfectly identifiable absorption spectrum. And you just say, hey, there's the CO2. And it happens to line up pretty darn well with where the dust is. So you've kind of already referenced this a lot, but when a giant molecular cloud, which you only have to understand as some kind of nebula, you don't have to remember that word at all, reaches a critical density, probably because some kind of supernova explosion and or starburst sent a shockwave through it, gravity wins over the gas pressure, and the star starts to collapse. Excuse me, the cloud starts to collapse, giving birth to new stars. As a cloud collapses, individual fragments will form. Each of these fragments will fragment further into individual stars, and that's going to form a group of stars called a star cluster. Now, if you want to be really fancy, astronomers would call this an open cluster. So there's an open cluster. This picture, I'm 100% sure, was taken by the Hubble. There's no other telescope that could really do it. And the reason I'm sure that it was taken by the Hubble is that a bunch of these stars are red. Red hot, red stars are not bright at all. They're super hard to see. And so I think this must be the Hubble Space Telescope, because it's really the only instrument that we have that's capable of doing this kind of work. It's also broken as all get out. Like, most of the gyroscopes on it have failed, and astronomers are kind of holding it together with the coding equivalent of gum and hope. Like, it can barely turn itself anymore. We really need a new one if you care about astronomy. All the stars in an open cluster would have been born at the same time, from the same material, in the same initial cloud. That means they all have the same chemical signatures. Now, our star has been around the Milky Way around 20 times, give or take. Like, we think of our star as being old, but the Milky Way is also super big. Given how big the Milky Way is, we've only orbited it 20 times. But our star was surely born in an open cluster like this. And our star is also super chemically complicated. So you should be able to look out there and find other stars that are similarly chemically complicated and in the same kind of way. Sister stars or brother stars, if you wish. We haven't found one yet. Like, the rotation of the galaxy eventually spreads stars out, and we have yet to find another star that was born out of the same giant molecular cloud as our star was. Maybe someday. Here are more open clusters of starbirth regions, shown only because they're pretty. I'll let you all have a moment to take them in, and then onward. So how do the individual stars form? Like I said, some kind of combination between what a figure skater does and what pizza dough does as you spin it above your head. The interior is spinning faster and faster, and every layer out from the interior is speeding slower and slower. That allows bands to form, all of which are moving at different velocities. If the bands are moving at different velocities, then they have a tendency to gravitationally clump together. And so you get different planets. It's that simple. Well, it's not that simple. Actually, it's a severe problem. I spent a while talking to an astrophysicist who works on planet formation, and basically the whole conversation summed down to, it's pretty easy to make a big pile of junk that's 10 to 100 kilometers big. But after that, if you have more junk hitting it, it's really hard to get the velocity profiles to work so the new junk sticks instead of just breaking the object apart and making it so there's more pieces in the ring. And yet somehow it happens. Somehow each of those rings is going to form an entirely separate planet. Nobody knows how right now. And eventually, if you're on the Sol system, you get a sun and a bunch of rocky planets around it, and then a bunch of asteroids, which would have liked to have been a planet, but there's a gigantic gas giant right outside of it, and Jupiter has gravitationally harassed the asteroid belt to the point that it's never going to form a planet, and it doesn't even have enough mass left to form a planet right now. The ring that makes up the asteroid belt used to have at least 10 times more mass in it than it does now. So that happened to the poor asteroid belt. But all the inner planets had formed in their distinct bands and were able to gravitationally coalesce until there was just one object left there. Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars. Here are some artist conceptions of what a protostar might look like. So the star in the center has a powerful magnetic field, and just the same as the Earth's magnetic field spirals cosmic rays into the North and South Pole, the star's magnetic fields cause ejections to happen at the North and South Pole of the star. So those are artist conceptions. Here's what we can see of what's really happening. So the jets coming from the North and South Pole of the stars are definitely real. Those are some grainy pictures, and it's hard to tease data out of it. One of the things that's true about protostars is that they're not protostars for very long. It is a fast process. And because it's a fast process, there's hardly any of them around the universe to see. But the basic idea is always the same. Material moves towards a protostar, an accretion disk, and jets flow out of the north and the south magnetic pole of the stars, and the outflows flow away from the young star in the disk. And then a bunch of bands flow within the accretion disk, and eventually planets. Let me see if there's any point in this video if there's no sound real quick. I guess there's at least pretty animations. So let's roll with it. Oh, that is not right. Okay. Onward and upwards. So this is basically the formation of planetary systems, and I'd be remiss if I didn't take a moment and note that most star systems have at least two stars. So our star system is a little bit unique in that there's one G-class star in the center and nothing else. Now, I say there's nothing else. There's probably nothing else. There's a theory out there that we have some very dim dwarf companion that was in a super long orbit, and occasionally it plunges through something called the Oort cloud, and that's why we have massive extinctions every 550 million years or whatever it is. But who knows? It seems unlikely to me. So collapsing protostars can't do nuclear fusion yet, but they shine because they're warm. They're collapsing. There's pressure inward. There's gravity pulling it inward. It's warming up on the inside. That's creating some force that's pushing outwards. All this equals light. As a matter of fact, our sun shone more luminously as a protostar than it did as a fully grown-up star that was undergoing nuclear fusion, simply because it was so much bigger. Remember, it goes as temperature to the fourth, sure, but it also goes as area squared. So even though there's no fusion, protostars heat up, they're quite bright, they're quite luminous. Eventually, it's hot enough to begin nuclear fusion. And that's when it stops at more or less the same size, if everything goes well. Because the internal energy is pushing out as strongly as gravity is pulling in. Now, there's a whole bunch of stars that don't do this. There's a whole bunch of stars that expand and contract and expand and contract and expand and contract. They're called variable stars by astronomers, and they're really useful in terms of figuring out what's going on in the universe and how far away things are, but it also make them an extremely unnice place to live around. So all those variable stars are pretty much zero candidates for life. Protostars of different masses follow different paths on their way to the main sequence. For example, the very heaviest stars shine with about the same amount of light when they're protostars than when they become actual stars, because they're huge no matter what. The littler stars start out shining quite a bit more luminously, and that luminosity decreases until they finally assume their final stage, which is way smaller and hence less luminous. It's called the Hayashi track. And the sun only spends about 30 million years on the Hayashi track. It spends 10 billion years on the main sequence. This is why it's so hard to find good protostars out there to study. Because star systems spend only a very brief period of time in the protostar stage contracting. And they spend much, much, much more time just being a main sequence star. So that's what the Hayashi track looks like as an artist imagines it. From very big and glowing just because it's hot, to being much smaller and glowing because there's fusion. So protostars of mass less than 8% of the mass of the sun and smaller than that will never make it to the main sequence. They will never get hot enough to fuse hydrogen into helium, period. So here's another beautiful picture of a nebula. And by this point, I'm hoping that you're able to see the features that I'd like you to see. There's protostars forming. They have jets coming out of their north and south magnetic pole, shooting away from them. The nebula itself is being destroyed by the shockwave that comes from the star, and soon that nebula will become a star birth place for other stars. Orion, very hot star forming region. When you look at it in the infrared, which we used to be able to do, you can see that there's a bunch of new stars being born, but they're also obscured by dust, so you can't see them directly. But Orion's Sword is going to give birth to a ton of new stars. As groups age, remember, blue stars die very, very, very quickly. And so the older group is, the more red stars there are by proportion. And the younger group is, the more blue stars there are by proportion. I'm not going to do that for y'all. I think I will give y'all a couple of astro quizzes just to see if you're learning at all. But I'm not going to do the review sessions because y'all are physics 241 students. Stars that never reach the main sequence are called brown dwarfs. So OBA fine guy or girl, kiss me, is real stars. And LTY are brown dwarfs. They're not real stars. And the reason they're not real stars is that they can get hot enough to fuse hydrogen into deuterium, but they can't make it all the way to helium. So only that step happens. So they are creating a little energy through fusion, but they aren't filling up with helium. They're filling up with deuterium, which would make entrepreneurs super excited to get out there and mine them. Like, we need deuterium, but they still have a tremendous amount of gravity. Jupiter itself only has 1/50th of the mass necessary to become the smallest brown dwarf, and Jupiter is by far the most massive planet in the solar system. So just imagine going down into something that is 50 times the mass of Jupiter, getting some gas, and then leaving again. It would be a technologically daunting prospect, to say the least. So, I guess I said the wrong thing. Brown dwarfs can form with as little as 12-ish times the mass of Jupiter. At 65 times the mass of Jupiter, it would officially be a star, an M-type star, a red dwarf. It can actually fuse hydrogen into helium, not just hydrogen into deuterium. For brown dwarfs, when they're done fusing deuterium, they're just going to cool off and eventually be supported by electron degeneracy pressure, just like a white dwarf, which you don't know what a white dwarf is yet, but you're going to find out. And it takes a while for them to cool off that much. Review question, how many hours of daylight can you anticipate per day at the equator in the winter? How about the summer? So the answer is seasons don't really matter to the equator. They get about 12 hours of daylight and 12 hours of nighttime no matter what. The max amount of daylight you get in the North and South Poles is 24 hours. And the minimum amount of daylight you get is 0 hours. For both the North and the South Poles, there are long periods, months worth of time, when the sun is always up and the sun is always down. So let's talk about exoplanets. When I was born, we didn't know if there were other planets out there, period. Turns out there are. There's a lot of other planets out there. There's a few different ways we can detect them. The most common is a Doppler shift. So gravity works for all objects. If you have a planet orbiting around a star, at the same time the star is dragging the planet around in a gigantic circle, the planet's going to drag the star around into a really small circle. So it'll be blue shift as it's approaching us and red shift as it's receding for us. This only works when the plane of the planet is aligned with Earth, which is not very common. But the planets we found via this technique are usually called hot Jupiters, because the more massive a planet is and the closer it is into its star, the easier it is to detect that way. Another way, you can measure by how much the light of the star dims as a planet passes in front of it. Again, this only works if the plane the orbits is pretty much exactly aligned with the Earth. If it has any other orientation, it really doesn't work. And so it's a tiny fraction of the star systems out there. That being said, this is an old graph, but we have found a lot of planets. Like a lot. Thousands. We found enough planets that, given the limitation of our mechanisms for finding planets, we can just say right off the bat, almost every star has a bunch of planets. We can just assume that. Like, it seems like it is a natural consequence of star system formation that you get planets. Another old graph, massive exoplanets discovered by years. So we found out finding the heaviest exoplanets. And then as our instrumentation improved, we found lighter and lighter exoplanets until the point where we're finding exoplanets that have almost the same mass as Earth. So we're almost done, and it's only 7:30, so y'all should be happy. A word about life. Life is complicated. In a little bit, I'm going to show you an equation called the Drake equation. Depending on the numbers you assume that go into the Drake equation, there should either be in between 400,000 intelligent civilizations in the Milky Way, or else there should be 0.00000009 intelligent civilizations in the Milky Way. So with the most pessimistic numbers, the chances of there being intelligent life in the Milky Way are super small. And if you look out at the observable universe, probably only a very small handful of galaxies would have intelligent life, and we would never hear from them because of the speed of light. So no one knows, but let's take a quick look at some of the weird environments that support life on Earth. So we see chlorophyll almost everywhere. Chlorophyll is the thing that created free atmospheric oxygen that killed off almost every form of life on the planet. It does not appear to be that hard for chlorophyll to evolve once you have unicellular life. We have life that lives next to superheated water filled with minerals and metal sulfide. This is why life would actually last longer on Earth if the sun were to disappear and the Earth were to careen off into outer space and develop a thick outer layer of ice. Because life would still exist next to the hydrothermal vents. Whereas if we hang out next to the sun for too much longer, unless humans do something about it, all the water on Earth will evaporate within 500 million years. But if we were to just careen off into outer space and get a thick ice layer, then probably life could subsist before it freezes out for another 10 to 15 billion years. Here is some life that exists in a super acidic environment. Here is some life that exists in a super saline environment, which presumably if you live in Napa, you can drive out and see this. It's right near San Francisco. The most likely candidates for life are Jupiter's four moons, excepting for the one on the left, which is awful. It's just super hot and has constant volcanic activity and almost no atmosphere. But Europa, the one to the right of the one on the left, and Ganymede and Calypso all definitely have water on them. So we think water is the easiest way to get life. Europa has a lot of water. Like, it's got so much water, when you look at it, you're seeing an outer crust of ice. And in general, a moon or a planet will cool off at a rate that's roughly proportional to its size. That's why Earth still has heat, Venus still has heat, Mars doesn't, because Mars is much smaller. Europa is too small to be holding on to any heat from its own formation or radioactive materials in its core, but doesn't really matter because it's heated by tidal forces in between Jupiter and all the rest of the moons. So the core is hot just because other things are tugging on it. The core is hot enough that there is certainly 100% for sure a liquid ocean in between the outer layer of ice and the hot core. It's probably a really big liquid ocean. There is another picture of Europa. Here's Encephalus, which is an orbit around Saturn. We're even more sure that Encephalus has water because it's got a gigantic geyser that appears to be permanently coming out of the South Pole. And we flew the probe Cassini through it in order to confirm that, yes, in fact, it is a plume of giant water. Cassini is part of the reason that we can explain the longevity of Saturn's rings, although it's not putting out enough water to really fully explain it. Rings are unstable. Earth has had rings several times in its history. All those rings are now mixed with the surface of the planet because they all fell to the ground. Why does Saturn still have rings? And there's really only two possible reasons. Reason number one is that they're super new. They come from some moon that got blasted into pieces. Reason number two is that something's happening that we don't understand. Here's Titan. Again, Titan's the only other planet in the solar system that has a nitrogen atmosphere. It's got seas made out of methane. That appear and disappear all the time because methane is highly volatile. And so a bunch of the planet's liquid. Titan actually looks a lot like what we think Earth used to look like. And when the sun reaches its giant phase, Titan's going to heat up by about as much as Earth got heaten up. And so even though it won't have a very long lifespan because suns don't live that long when they start to die, it is possible that Titan might become somewhat Earth-like for a little bit. Here's what Earth looks like after Carl Sagan talked the NASA people into turning Voyager around one more time and snapping a picture. This picture is generally called the pale blue dot. It's just meant to emphasize that our planet is tiny, the universe is big. This is all we got. So take care of it, or not. So where is everyone? I can't play this video because it's almost all talking, but I can paraphrase it. So there's something called Fermi's paradox. And the point of Fermi's paradox is this. If there's life out there, then why haven't we seen it? Is it incredibly uncommon, or is there some other reason? Because the galaxy has been existing for several billion years. There should have been time for intelligent civilization to evolve. Fermi didn't know about 3D printers at the time he was alive, but he didn't know that given the capacity to even be able to travel at 10% of the speed of light, you should be able to get all over the galaxy in about a million years or so, which is not that big in comparison to a billion. And now that we do understand 3D printers, it's hard to see what would hold a civilization back. You could just send out an unmanned robotic probe, gets to a new system, mines the resources in that system, uses it to create more copies of itself, and then goes out from there to a new star system, mines the resources, uses it to create more copies of itself, so on and so forth. That could be done. There's no reason why it couldn't be. Our science has advanced to the point that it's clearly possible. It's not meaningful over the timescale of a human lifespan, which is part of the reason why we're not really seriously looking into it, because There's no way it would benefit anybody who's alive now, but it still could be done. So, if there's aliens out there, we should be seeing them. Unless we're the very first intelligent civilization, or one of the very first intelligent civilizations to evolve in the galaxy, we should know about the others. So, why not? Well, here's a direct equation. And I can't see my notes when I'm in full screen mode to tell you what these are, but R is the rate of star formation. We know very precisely what that is. F sub P is the rate at which planets are formed. We now know that that number is almost one. Like, it seems like every single star system has planets. N sub E is the number of those planets that is Earth-like enough to generate life, which is kind of a silly number, because there might easily be life on Europa or Encephalus, and they're not Earth-like at all. They just have liquid water. I don't remember what F sub L is. I guess the rate at which planets develop life. And we don't have a lot of data for that, but we do know that life evolved on Earth almost the very instant that Earth's surface stopped being a molten mess. Like, we got right started. Is that a lucky thing? Or is that what happens on every planet? F sub I is what proportion of planets develop intelligent life. Again, that's really hard to estimate. F sub E is what proportion of intelligent life develops some kind of communication we can see, probably radio communication. And L is the length of time that that radio communication exists. Earth is much less radio bright now than it was when I Love Lucy was on. It's just an inefficient use of energy. Like, you don't want to be beaming radio waves out into outer space if you can get away from it. You're using more energy than you have to. Consequently, 90% of the internet is not done via satellites. And if it is done via satellites, it's done via very narrow beams. It's done by gigantic fiber optic cables that just lie on the bottom of the ocean. So we are radio quieter year after year after year just because it's a more efficient way to handle our energy, and we don't want to waste energy. And so the Earth itself, if some intelligent civilization were out there looking for us, is getting harder and harder and harder to detect. Not because we're deliberately trying to hide, just because we're trying to save on the power bill. And it seems like any other intelligent civilization would want the same thing. Like, nobody wants to waste energy. You don't have to waste. Oh, wait. I have more to say than this before we get onto the asteroid belt. There is an idea out there in astronomy and amongst people that are doomsday predictors called the Great Filter. And the idea behind this is that, let's suppose life is super easy to get started, as it indeed appears to be. Then, of course, not every planet that has life is going to develop intelligent life, but a lot of them would. The estimate would be that it's more like 400,000 intelligent civilizations in the Milky Way than there is like 0.0000008. So there must be some point in the evolution of life where there is a gigantic barrier that stops life from existing. Now, the key question would be, where is that barrier? Like, we got unicellular life really quickly. That's what it was for a billion years. Until finally some cell figured out how to eat another cell. And then the two cells were able to split and carry off copies of both cells. That's the difference between a protist and a, gosh, I don't even remember what the name of cells like bacteria are. Put it in the chats if you do. Eukaryotes and prokaryotes would be a more scientific way of referring to it, with eukaryotes being the more complicated organism that took us a billion years to get to, and prokaryotes being the sort that we immediately started with. So maybe that's the barrier. Or maybe the barrier is that it's really hard to get life to be so intelligent that it can start to use tools at the level of sophistication that humans do. I mean, our brains are so big that a significant proportion of the human population die during childbirth. That is not true of kangaroos. And so we're really pushing the evolutionary envelope of what is possible. Maybe it's that intelligent life is common, but the circumstances under which they live is not conducive to developing technology like we do. I mean, Earth's crust is in orbit around us in the form of the moon, so we have easy access to metals. We don't all live underwater, which really, I would imagine, helps with developing things like fire and tool use, so on and so forth. But if none of those things are the great filter, then the great filter is in front of us. So maybe most intelligent civilizations get killed by bacteriological warfare, or by nuclear explosions, or because there's some random alien race out there that just wanders around snuffing up out life once it becomes too complicated. There's no way of knowing, but it does appear extremely likely by this point that life will be super common. So where's the filter? Why are we the only species we know of that has gotten to be intelligent and have this level of tool use? All I can say for sure is that if we get to Europa and there's a bunch of fish there, then it's none of the things before fish, which kind of bodes ill for what's going to happen to humans, because most of the steps that could be barriers happen before fish. Like, once you're a multicellular organism, you have something like mitochondria inside of you, you can synthesize energy, you've got a brain. All that stuff seems like it might be really hard to evolve, but if it's not, then we probably have a problem going forward, and no one can really say what it is. But one thing we can say for sure is that the galaxy is not crowded with intelligent life. If it is here, it's very uncommon. Or we're the first. We're the first to get this far. One of those two things. Now the asteroid belt. So the asteroid belt in the solar system is a lot more empty than you might suppose. If your typical asteroid was scaled down to be the size of a potato, and you scaled everything else in the solar system down to be the same size, there'd be several kilometers in between the potatoes. Like, NASA doesn't worry about their probes hitting asteroids when they go through the asteroid belt. Rather, they mindfully try to figure out if there's any way that they could steer that probe by an asteroid in order to get a good picture so that we can get some new data. Your odds of randomly hitting an asteroid on your way through the belt are less than 1 in a billion. There did used to be a lot more mass there. Like, it probably could have formed a real planet, but it's next to our biggest planet. Jupiter has gravitationally harassed the asteroid belt, knocking out about 90% of its mass over the eons. The largest object in the asteroid belt is Ceres. Ceres alone has about a third of the total current mass in the asteroid belt. It's big enough that it's pulled itself into a spherical shape. There's a lot of ice in the asteroid belt. When the sun was a protostar, it was bright enough that it burnt off what is called volatiles on all the inner planets and about halfway through the asteroid belt. It means all the ice was gone, all the ammonia was gone, anything that might be in ice at anything close to room temperature got evaporated by the sun. We only got stuff like water back because the planets moved around a lot, and that knocked comets out of the Oort belt, and a large number of those comets ended up in the inner solar system, hitting the inner solar system planets and giving us back water, which had previously been evaporated. That's all I know. I'll teach chapter 36 or whatever it is tomorrow, and I'll send out an email and I'll announce it. I'm a little worried about how few questions there are. I get more questions from my astronomy students, and y'all know quite a bit more about science than my astronomy students. Again, hit exclamation mark enter if you're here and paying attention.
I have a question about the homework.
All right. So a lot of you are tuned in. Yes. Please tell me your question about the homework.
So there's one that says it's due tomorrow and it's chapter 37. Do you want to finish up till chapter 37 or up to chapter 35?
No, chapter 37 is like relativity, or maybe even modern physics.
Okay.
Let me check real quick. I was logged into Mastering Physics, although I'm sure I'm kicked out by now. But we definitely have not covered chapter 37. Like, I think the latest we did was chapter 36, if not chapter 35. Which one was interference and diffraction and polarization and all that stuff?
Chapter 35.
Okay, so that's a big no on chapter 36. Mm-hmm. Don't even go there. There's been zero discussion, so on and so forth.
Yeah, the only one I see is the problem solving chapter 37 due tonight at midnight. Just double checking.
I'm logging into Master Physics right now. I'm going to push that off until next Wednesday without knowing really at all when it's actually going to be due, but certainly no earlier than next Wednesday. Other questions? And if you care about making me think that my teaching is worthwhile, I particularly appreciate a question about astronomy. All right. Well, then all I got to say is that I hope you all are getting something out of this. I've got a lab that's directly relevant to what I taught you today, so I'll post that very soon, and I'll continue to try to be on top of Canvas to keep everything updated and graded. And every day I should be more caught up than I was the day before until we're actually caught up. Have a great evening. If anybody has any questions over astronomy or physics, shoot me an email. Come to one of my office hours, which I have very poor attendance at, and so you can have my full attention. And, you know, just let me know. I'm here to teach you science, and it's really hard for me to know if that's what I'm doing right now. Take care, y'all. Bye.